Good morning. Let us start the lecture. Optical fiber communication, D83201. Course outcomes. The students will be able to understand the different communication media, various blocks, and applications of optical fiber communication system. The students will be able to understand the optics rules and measure the optical fiber cable parameters. Students will be able to identify suitable optical source for a given application. Students will be able to identify suitable optical detector for a given application. Students will be able to identify suitable connectors and measure the losses in the optical fiber cable. Students will be able to understand architecture of the optical fiber network for the given application. So, characteristic of optical sources, three types. One is continuous spectra, incandescent light is example, monochromatic incoherent, LED, monochromatic coherent, laser. All these we have discussed in previous lectures. Then optical sources requirements are the size and configurable. Source must have the size and configurable to its to be compatible with its launching light. And light output is highly directional. So it must accurately track the electrical input to minimize the distortion noise. Source should be linear. Source should emit the light at a wavelength where the fiber has low loss, low dispersion, and detectors are efficient. Preferably capable of simple signal modulation over a wide bandwidth extending from audio frequency beyond gigahertz range. Then source must couple sufficient optical power to overcome attenuation in the fiber and connectors losses and receive adequate power to drive the detector. And source should have very narrow spectral bandwidth so as to reduce, minimize the dispersion. Dispersion gives losses. Source must be capable of maintaining stable optical output unaffected by the changes in ambient conditions, that is temperature. And source is to be comparatively cost effective, cheap and highly reliable in order to compete with conventional transmission line techniques. Then principle of working of optical source. We know light is in form of photons. Photon is a discrete packet of energy or quanta. Interaction of the light takes place with the matter, semiconductor material which produces the light, and quantum theory suggests that atoms exist only in certain discrete energy states, and absorption and emission of light causes atom to make transition from one discrete energy state to another discrete energy state. Then the principle of working of optical source. There are three phenomena, mechanisms, absorption, spontaneous emission, and stimulated emission. In absorption, whenever the atom is at the lower energy state, conducts valence energy state, and external photon is get absorbed, external photon is having the energy equal to band gap energy, then atom transits from lower energy state to higher energy state. That means valence to conduction energy state. This is called absorption of the photon. And when there is a atom at the upper energy state, conduction energy state, and when the charged particle or atom jumps comes to the valence energy state from higher to lower, it emits the energy equal to band gap energy as a photon. This is spontaneous emission. Randomly it takes place and all the photons are not in phase. So this spontaneous emission is monochromatic but incoherent. It is observed in LED. It is monochromatic because every time the photon emitted is equal to band gap energy and that is fixed. Then next is lastly stimulated emission, in which the atom is in the higher energy state, that conduction energy state. Charged particle is in the conduction energy state, possessing the conduction amount of energy. And when external photon of energy value equal to band gap energy interacts with the atom structure, then the higher energy state charged particle emits the energy equal to band gap energy equal to the external interacting atomic energy and transits from higher energy state to lower energy state. This is due to the external interacting photon, therefore it is stimulated emission. Then after generation of the photon, due to transition from higher energy state to lower energy state, the generated photon, that is stimulated emitted photon and stimulating external interacting photon, both are having same energy values, are having same phase and direction, they travel together. Due to this same phase and same direction, same phase basically, the addition of photon energy takes place in constructive manner. That means the incident wave of the external photon and emitted photon, emitted wave, both are in constructive manner added together constructively. So this is stimulated emission is observed in the laser, because this adds constructively, that means amplification takes place. So it is light amplification by stimulated emission of photons, or light amplification with stimulated emission of photon. So working principle of source absorption and emission of radiation, in which the frequency of absorbed or emitted radiation F is equal to or related to difference in energy, that is E, and that difference is from higher energy state to lower energy state, E2 to E1. So E is E2 minus E1, that is HF, HF, that is the photon energy, either absorbed or emitted. So photon absorbed must have or is having band gap energy, or photon emitted is also having band gap energy, where HF, F is frequency and H is Planck's constant, and this is 6.626 into 10⁻³⁴ joule second. So this is the working principle. Then in working principle, absorption of the light photon, whenever the atom is considered two energy state atom or two level atomic structure, energy level atomic structure, then atom is initially in the lower energy state and photon of energy E2 minus E1 is incident on the atom, then it goes from lower to higher energy state, from E1 to E2, to absorption of photon. This is absorption. Then emission of the radiation in the form of light or photon, if again two energy state or two energy level atomic system is considered, and where the atom is initially at higher energy state, that is conduction energy state or E2 or EC, it can make a transition to the lower energy state E1 or EV, lower energy state or valence energy state, providing the emission of photon at frequency E equal to E2 minus E1, that is HF. This emission are of two types, one is spontaneous emission, second is stimulated emission. So in case of emission radiation, the photon, as the these two types of emissions are there. If you consider the first one, spontaneous emission, in which the atom returns to lower energy state entirely in random manner, so it is in random nature of the spontaneous emission process. It emits light by electronic transitions in large number of atoms. So electron transits from higher energy state to lower energy state, conduction energy state to valence energy state. It gives the incoherent radiation. As it is random, it is incoherent radiation. The emission process in semiconductor is the mechanism for light generation within the LED. So this emission process or mechanism observed in the LED. The next is stimulated emission. So again, the emission radiation two types. One is spontaneous, second is emission, stimulated. So consider the stimulated emission, when the photon is again having photon is having an energy equal to the energy difference between two states in stimulated emission, that is E2 minus E1, interact an external photon having energy equal to difference between two states E2 minus E1, interacts with the atom in the upper energy state atom that causes it to return to lower energy state. When external photon interact with the atom of upper energy state, the upper energy state atom comes to lower energy state by creating one photon. So external photon atom creates one more photon. So in this case, it emits photon generally of identical energy to the incident photon. Because incident photon is of E2 minus E1, then emitted or radiated or generated photon is also E2 minus E1. So both are same energy photons. It is having light of stimulating and stimulated photon in phase with same polarization. Hence the same phase and same polarization. Hence it is coherent radiation. It adds incident wave as well as radiated wave, liberated wave, in the constructive manner, providing the amplification. So this provides the amplification, giving laser an optical source with all properties. Laser means light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. So this is the construction of the PN junction, and electron is filled circle, holes are empty circles, acceptor with negative in circle, donors ions are positive in circle. So in P type, lot of acceptor ions are there and lot of holes are there, and some electrons are also there. In N type, lot of donor ions are there, lot of electrons are there, majority charge carriers, and some holes are also there, minority charge carriers. When the PN junction is formed, N type and P type are joined together. Actually, it is not joined. The doping of the different impurities are made on same semiconductor material on two sides. So that forms the depletion layer. So whenever the junction is there, depletion layer is formed, and depletion layer is nothing but neutralization of the atoms by exchanging the charged particles of opposite polarity. So up to certain distance, this mechanism takes place by neutralizing the atoms. So donor atom gives electron to the acceptor atoms, which are lack of electron, and hence electron hole recombination takes place, and this makes the both atoms stable by completing the octet, and they become neutralized in the electrical conduction. And this electrical conduction neutralizes the material, further avoids the charged particle travel through. So in energy band diagram, due to the impurity doping, on y-axis energy is shown, on x-axis the location in the lattice crystal, distance in the lattice crystal is shown. So Fermi energy level, average energy level is there, and the conduction and valence energy states are lifted or shifted upward in the p-type region, and they are shifted downward in the n-type region. Therefore, the conduction state energy in n-type and conduction state energy in the p-type are having the difference in their potential. So this is called potential difference barrier. So electrons present in the n-type region having the less energy as compared to electrons present in the p-type, in both in conduction state. So the electrons in n-type, if they want to go into the n-type to p-type, then they have to cross this potential barrier, change in difference in potential. So this is for potential barrier, and this potential barrier is reduced and electrons are given the higher energy to cross into the p-type conduction energy level. We have to bias the crystal. External biasing is done with the voltage source. same is there with the holes. They are at different valence energy state. So whenever the forward biasing of p-n junction is done, the potential barrier reduces, becomes less, and external voltage gives the extra energy to the electrons on the n side to go to the energy state in the p zone. So whenever the electron is in the conduction state, external power supply gives energy to raise its energy to make up the energy equal to conduction energy equal to the conduction energy of, or energy equal to conduction energy of p type region, and therefore electron can move from n type to p type. Similarly for holes, they can move from p type to n type, and whenever plenty of electrons are present in the p type, they get recombined with the holes in the same region and they emit the photon of value band gap energy HF. Similarly for n region, plenty of electrons are already there, and if the holes due to crossing the junction they become large number, plenty of holes are available, then the electron hole recombination takes place by emitting the energy equal to band gap energy HF. So this both will take place in the radiations will take place in the both the regions, n as well as p. So spontaneous emission may be of again two types. Spontaneous emission is due to the spontaneous recombination of electron hole combination, but it may, there is recombination may be of two types, radiative and non-radiative. So radiative and non-radiative. So this is because in recombination sometimes the photon is emitted, but in some radiations that is called non-radiative recombination, the energy released is dissipated in form of lattice vibration. As energy is released, immediately it is dissipated into the atomic lattice vibration, mechanical energy, and then that get converted into the thermal energy or heat energy. So this is non-radiative recombination. These are very less in number. So that's why the conversion efficiency from electrical to optical is not one, it is less than one. Whatever the percentage of radiative recombinations are there, that will be the conversion efficiency. The radiative recombination, as we know, the energy released as light photon equal to band gap energy, Eg, with frequency of n to be n by Eg is equal to Hf or Hc upon lambda. Where C is the velocity of light in vacuum, lambda is the optical wavelength, Hc is Planck's constant. If we substitute H 6.626 into 10 to the minus 34 joule second unit, and C is 2.998. 10^2 plus 8 meters per second is the unit. So these are the SI unit. We have to always solve the problem by substituting the SI unit. We can calculate lambda by substituting H and C and Eg, or we can calculate Eg by substituting H, C and lambda. Okay. So suppose if you rearrange, lambda is taken on this side, Eg on other side, lambda equal to Hc upon Eg. If you substitute H in joule second, C in meter per second, we have to substitute Eg in joule. Okay, Eg must be substituted in joule. But for simplicity of the problem solving, we substitute Eg, which is available in electron hole many times. So if we want to substitute energy in electron hole, so electron hole to joule conversion formula 1.6 into 10^-19 is already substituted in the formula and rearranged such that this becomes 1.24 10^-7, and if you sorry, 12.4 10 raised to minus 7. So if you make 1.24 10 raised to minus 6 as only 1.24, so lambda also will come as micrometer. So this formula H is equal to 1.24 divided by EZ we can use, where we have to substitute lambda in terms of micrometer and EZ in terms of electron volt. Okay, if we use lambda in micrometer, EZ in electron volt, this formula will work. That is, lambda is equal to 1.24 upon EZ, or EZ is equal to 1.24 upon lambda. So that how this substitution makes this formula, that derivation also we have seen yesterday and day before that. So this is spontaneous emission in the p-n junction structure. The ohmic contacts are there, metallization is there on both the side. Okay, this is metallization, metal contacts, and this is the external wires. To these external wires, n type of the region connected, negative of the power supply, p type of the region connected, positive of the power supply, and this becomes forward biased p-n junction. And as the p-n junction is forward biased, large number of majority charge carriers from n region electrons and large number of charge particles in p region, that is holes, they cross this junction. So electron goes into p region, holes goes into n region, and they electron hole, they recombine by giving the photons HF. These recombines, combination emits the photons, So it emits the photons, and that is equal to HF. All the photons are having same value, energy value, that is H into F. Frequency is constant. So that is having wavelength constant, and that wavelength is corresponding to the band gap energy of this material of which the crystal lattice is manufactured. So whatever the material, semiconductor material having the band gap energy, that energy is emitted as the photon. And this is the random process. Okay? So it is, photons emitted are not having the same direction, same phase. So this source becomes in spontaneous emission if this source becomes incoherent. So it is observed in the LED, but it is monochromatic because each time same lambda is emitted. So this is in case of LED. For laser, the crystal structure must have population inversion. So population inversion is nothing but whenever we consider the density of atom in the semiconductor crystal, all the atoms in the semiconductor crystal follow the Boltzmann distribution curve, the dotted curve as shown here. This says that whenever there are two energy levels, suppose E1 and E2, E1 is the conduction energy state, valence energy state, E2 is the conduction energy state. Then valence energy state number of atoms will follow this curve and will have this value, where this energy level on the curve is having that same number of atoms are present in the material. Similarly, for conduction state energy level, where when the conduction state energy level E2 is there on curve, what is the value of the E2? That point is assumed as that much number of atoms are in that state. So this is controlled by Boltzmann distribution. Suppose if E2 is at this point, for this value of E2, whatever the number of electrons are there, number of electrons or number of atoms are there, so those are will be here, okay, on the graph. So similarly for E1. If another E1 is there, suppose this E1, then in that case, this number of electrons or this number of atom density number of atoms will be present at that energy level. Now, this is in the thermal equilibrium. What is in the thermal equilibrium? Low level energy or valence state energy, number of atoms are N1 or more. And high level energy, that is the conduction level energy, number of atoms are N2, less. So, valence state number of atoms are large and conduction state number of atoms are less. So, conduction state number of atoms are less and valence state number of atoms are more, that is N2 less than N1. So, this is in the thermal equilibrium and it is observed normally in the material. Now, if we make it opposite, if N2 is less, more than N1, so this is called population inversion. That means number of atoms having E2 energy level are large and number of atoms having E1 energy state are less. So, N1 are less than N2. This is called population inversion. So, large number of atoms are present in higher energy state to transit from higher to lower to generate large number of photons. So, to generate large number of photons, population inversion is required. So, as we know, population inversion, in which the non-equilibrium distribution takes place with the population inversion. Uniform distribution means higher energy state number of atoms or atom density is larger, N2 is larger than lower energy state number of atoms or atom density, that is N1. So, N2 is more than N1. So, this is called population inversion. Large number of higher energy state atoms are present to transit from higher energy state to lower energy state to give the number of photons. So, this is population inversion. Now, let us discuss the optical fabric effect, that is optical feedback and laser oscillation. This is the effect, special mechanism, laser oscillation, which is useful for laser optical output generation. So, am I audible? Please no feedback so that we can continue our discussion. Thank you, Sujesh. So, let us consider this particular structure. So, this is basic laser structure. Laser structure. What is there in the structure? In this structure, one medium is there, amplifying medium, in between two mirrors. So, this medium is semiconductor material medium. Amplifying medium is semiconductor material medium, which is placed in two mirrors. And these two mirrors are placed at particular distance capital L, which is called mirror facets. Two mirror facets are placed at a distance capital L. And these mirrors are placed by polishing the, mirrors are made by polishing the semiconductor material. One mirror from that is perfectly reflecting mirror, completely reflecting the photons, light. and second mirror is partially reflecting the light. So perfectly reflecting light cannot pass the optical output on the other side. It reflects 99.99% light coming or incident on it. So mirror with perfect reflection cannot pass the light through it. Whereas the mirror which is partially reflecting will partially reflect the number of photons and partially transmit or pass through it the photon. So from this particular mirror the light output is also possible. So optical output is also possible. So this is the construction of the basic structure incorporating the plane mirrors for the laser. Okay. Now if you consider this light amplification, this light amplification in laser occurs when, these are the conditions, when the light amplification occurs, the photon collides with atom in excited energy state, or photon interacts with the atom which is in higher energy state. Okay, so this is the condition. When the light amplification in the laser takes place, whenever photon interacts with the atom at higher energy state. Second, causes the stimulated emission. Such interaction must cause the stimulated emission. Then amplification takes place. It should cause the stimulated emission of a second photon. Then amplification takes place. If stimulated emission is caused, then the incident photon and stimulated photon, output photon, generated photon will have same phase. And this same phase makes the amplification because of constructive addition of the waves. And these two photons in previous case due to stimulated emission further releases two more photons. And that means this chain is continued of releasing more and more number of photons. This continue process creates avalanche multiplication. Just like the avalanche breakdown in the diodes, isn't it? There are two types of breakdowns in the diodes, avalanche breakdown and Zener breakdown. Just like that, the avalanche multiplication takes place. That means chain of the multiplication. Two photons will collide on two more atom structures and releases two more photons. Total become four photons. These four photons interact with four more atoms and then they release four more photons. They totally becomes eight photons. These eight photons collide with eight more atom structures and releases eight more photons. Then incident eight photons and generated or radiated eight photons, total becomes 16 photons. 16 becomes 32, 32 becomes 64, 64 becomes 128, 128 becomes 520, isn't it? And this continues. So this process creates avalanche multiplication, and this generation is in generating in phase photons. So photons will get added constructively, the incident wave and liberated wave or radiated wave, they add together in phase constructively, and that makes the amplification. The electromagnetic wave of photon are in phase. So these waves, electromagnetic waves of the photons are in phase. So they are in phase. So it will create the amplification. it will create amplification or amplified coherent emission. For laser action, photons must be within laser medium. For this action, this is the medium. This is the medium, laser medium. Photons must be in this laser medium, that is semiconductor medium, which is in between the mirrors. So whatever the photons generated must maintain the condition for coherence. All the generated photon, incident photon, must maintain the condition of coherence. For this, plane or curved mirrors are placed or formed in the semiconductor material. For this, the curved mirror or plane mirror are made, placed or made there only with the polishing of the semiconductor material. So these mirrors are at either end of amplifying medium. So these mirrors are on both the sides of amplifying medium. And due to this mirror, whatever photons are generated, those photons are collide on this mirror and they get reflected back and goes on the other direction. They again collide on the other direction mirror, and due to reflection, they again go on back to the opposite direction. And this process continued for very long, continue all the time. And this reflection and traveling of the photons makes the chance of interacting the photon with the atom structure of optical source or device. Okay, to increase the probability of interaction of photon with the atom structure, the photons are continuously made to travel in same medium, and this continues for all the time. That makes the accumulated emissions continuously, and this material is already in the population inverted, that means large number of atom structures are in the higher energy state. So it is again having high possibility that photon may find atom structure of higher energy state. And higher energy state or population inversion is achieved by applying the external bias voltage. So this pumping is achieved by any of the energy source, photo energy source, thermal energy source, electromagnetic energy source, or voltage biasing to the piston. Electrical energy source, and due to this pumping, a continuous pumping, because the bias is connected continuously, a continuous higher energy state energy structures are created, and continuously these photons interact with higher energy state, and continuously photons are emitted, and these photons are reciprocating, that means they are traveling from one end to other end in the amplifying medium. So this is continuous process. Out of those number of photons which are oscillating in this between these two mirrors, some of the photons are emitted from one mirror as the output, optical output, because that mirror is semi-transparent or semi-reflecting. So optical output is obtained from single direction of the structure. So it is obviously the photons are very directive. So the optical output beam generated from through this mirror is also very directive, and all the photons are also incoherent, all in phase. So laser output is in phase, monochromatic and coherent. Monochromatic as well as coherent. And this mechanism continuously amplifying the photons, optical energy. Okay. So number of photons get multiplied by 2 every time. and they find number of atomic structures in the higher energy state due to pumping by external voltage source connected as a bias source, biasing source. So this is called, this particular structure is called Fabry-Perret's cavity. This is called Fabry-Perret's cavity. So, similar to the microwave cavities, these are the optical cavities. The cavity means the medium where the energy is allowed to oscillate or travel. Generally, oscillate, it is called cavity for the amplification or for some interference mechanism. So this is optical feedback, optical feedback and laser oscillation. Because whatever the optical energy generated, it is fed back by reflection to the same medium. So this is, this medium is acting as optical feedback as well as oscillating medium, which generates the laser oscillation with the help of feedback. Always, the amplifier mechanism requires feedback, isn't it? Oscillator mechanism requires feedback. If you go for the circuit amplifiers or circuit oscillators in the circuit theory, there must be either of the feedback, positive feedback or negative feedback. Whenever the part of the output is fed back to the input, it is called feedback. If that part of the output is in phase, it is called positive feedback. If part of the output is out of phase, it is called negative feedback. Okay. If negative feedback is there, amplification takes place. If positive feedback is there, oscillation takes place. Here the photons oscillate and they get feedback, fed back to the same medium. So they amplify because output is in phase. So this is the Fabry-Perret cavity, or having the optical feedback and laser oscillation, laser action. So optical feedback and laser oscillation, in which the optical cavity is formed in more analogous to oscillator than amplifier, okay, because of the in phase feedback of the energy. It provides the positive feedback of the photons by reflection at mirrors at either end of the cavity. So two mirrors are placed, mirror facets on the two ends of the laser structure or laser cavity, and they reflect the photons, and that's why they provide positive feedback on the photons. Optical signal is fed back many times while receiving the amplification as it passes through medium. Before giving as the output, optical output, that optical signal is many times reflected and fed back to the same medium. And then after many times of the oscillations, sometimes these photons are emitted as the output. So before becoming the output, those photons have interacted the medium many times due to the mirror reflection and oscillation in that medium. Okay. So it provides the feedback of photons by reflecting the mirrors on either end of the cavity, and optical signal is fed back many times while receiving amplification as it passes through medium. This structure acts as a breath error resonator. The amplification of the signal is small with single pass. Okay, the amplification signal is small with single pass. Okay, if single pass is there, that means photons are generated and once they are traveling in the medium and they are outputted. That is single pass. They are not oscillated again and again and again. Then the amplification of signal will be very, very small. Only once the photons interact the structure. So small amplification will be there. But multiple passes, that means photons are oscillated many times. From one mirror reflected, again goes to second mirror, again they are reflected, again goes to first mirror, again that is reflected. So these multiple passes offers the net gain as a large number. Net gain large. Large net gain will be obtained due to multiple passes. In this, one mirror is partially transmitting, partially transparent. So it is partially transmitting one mirror. Suppose 100 photons are incident on the mirror, say 40 photons it will pass through and they are emitted, but 60 photons it will reflect, depending on how much transparency or how much transmittivity is there. Okay, if 50% transmissivity is there, it will pass 50 photons out of 100 and 50 will be reflected. If 60 is there, 60 photons are reflected back, transmitted, 40 will be reflected back. Depends on the amount of transmitting. So one mirror partially transmitting the photons. Light radiation escape from the cavity through transmitting mirror. Okay. Light radiation are given as the output to escape to the transmitting. Okay. Then stable output is obtained as a saturation. Okay. Stable output is obtained at a saturation when the optical gain is exactly matched with by losses incurring in amplifying medium. So whatever the photons are generated, some photons are reabsorbed. These are the losses. If the losses are incurred in the medium are matched to the generated photons, then photon number will remain constant. Then the stable output is obtained. Otherwise, output will either die down. It will not be sustained oscillation. So oscillator must have sustained oscillator, whether in the electrical circuit or in the optical device or in the microwave. To have the sustained oscillation, the feedback and the generated will have, must have counter, or the losses and the generated must have equal balanced number. Okay, so stable output is obtained at the saturation when the optical gain is exactly matched by losses incurred in amplifying medium. So gain and loss, if they are matched, then the stable output is obtained of the photons or light source, light energy. So major losses are from absorption and scattering in the amplifying medium. So amplifying medium is semiconductor medium. So whatever the photons generated in the source, they are reabsorbed as well as scattered. Both are giving the losses, absorption and scattering.